Hello and welcome to another of MATLAB Helper's wonderful videos on the stock market with MATLAB. So in this episode, we'll look at the callbacks or the callback functions that we can use to perform some component-specific events in App Designer. So first of all, what we'll do is we'll see how we can add callbacks into our application. All right, so first of all, in the beginning of the application, there has to be some code that needs to be run, all right? So what we'll do is we'll just go to UI figure and go to callbacks and we'll just add a starter function callback. So since I already have that callback, I cannot add it anymore. So I'll just go into a temporary application, go to UI figure. So I can do it both in code view as well as in design view. So let me just show you from design view, I can go into callbacks and then from starter function, I can add a starter function from here. Okay, so I have the function over here now. Similarly, you'll see that here in this application, the code view, we have the starter function over here. You'll notice that we have some more arguments over here. We'll discuss about that in later episodes. So in the beginning of the application, so this particular callback runs when the application starts for the first time. So when I run this application, these few lines of code will be run. So now let's just think about what things we need to display when the code runs for the first time. First of all, we need to display the year values, the month values, and the date values, right? So that the user can actually choose from those values. So first, and you might be wondering like why we did not enter the values for year, month, and day by simply manually changing the values of the options, right? And that's because if you want to enter the year values from 1970 to 2019, you'll have to enter a lot of values. And that is really time consuming. So instead of doing that, what we'll do is we'll just write a few lines of code here that will allow us to do the same thing. So we'll begin with writing the options for the start year drop-down menu. So we'll just access the items feature of the drop-down menu. So you will see here that if I choose any drop-down menu, I'll get some features here like value, items, and item data. So items is actually the property which contains the options values, okay? So if we want to change the options displayed in a drop-down menu, we'll have to change the items property. So that's why we'll access the items from the start year drop-down and then we will save in it the year values. So I have used a cell str command to convert the string into a cell value. Now that is because drop-down menus only accept data of cell type. Now this num2str is to convert these date values to numeric values. So what we are using is colon here to get a tall array by taking the transpose of this array. So from 1970 to 2019, we are getting the year values and then converting it to a string value. After that, we are adding one more string term year above it and then converting it, this entire term, to a cell value over here. All right, so cell str actually converts array into a cell array of strings. Similarly, we can do the same for end year. For the start and end month drop downs, we'll simply write down the name of the months. We also add month here so that the first element that is displayed in the drop down menu will be month, just like year over here. We don't want to display the year value or the month value as the first element, all right? So similarly, we'll do the same for the dates. Now, dates are something that actually depends on the year, but for now, we'll assume that each day or each month has 31 days over here. So start day has 31 values starting from 1 to 31, and it also has a value called day at the beginning. So we have in total 32 values starting from day to the number 31. Similarly for end day, drop down menu as well. We are in the beginning also making the buttons disabled so that the user cannot press the buttons unless he has chosen all the values from the drop down menus. So we can make the buttons disabled by using the enable feature that you can find under interactivity. So by default, the buttons are visible as well as enabled, but we can change it to off. Okay, so we can just access the enable feature by using the dot notation again and making it equal to off. We can again make it on by simply changing the off to on in some other line of code. And finally, we have this line of code which we won't be needing for now. We'll need it in the future episodes. So we'll just forget about this line of code for now. Now let's just move on to the next callback function, shall we? So the next callback function is actually about drop-down menus. For now, we'll assume that each month has 31 days, right? But that assumption is kind of wrong because February, the amount of days in February especially depends upon which year it is, right? So what we'll do is we'll check if a year is leap year depending upon the value that of year that a person chooses from the start year and end year drop-down menus. So first of all, we'll have to make a callback for these drop-down menus, right? So we'll first go to the start year drop-down menu and go into callbacks, okay? And actually, instead of choosing the drop-down, the callback for start year, what we'll do is we'll just create a callback for start month. And that is because we are actually interested in which month we are choosing, right? Also the year, because some months have 30 days and some months have 31 days. All right, so let me just show you how we can do that by creating callback that we won't need in the future. So we'll make a value changed feedback, all right? So we'll do that for the start month. And if we go there, you'll find that we already have this first line of code written for us. Now this line of code, what it does is that it saves the value that the user has chosen from the drop-down menu in the variable called value, all right? So now we are saving that value in the variable value, and after that we are saving the value for the start year. Okay, so the start year drop down value is saved in the value year underscore s. Now we need the value for the year as well, because for the month February the days depend on the year. So for this particular callback we need both the value of the month and the year. Now depending upon which month has been chosen, so switch off the value of month chosen by the user. We'll obviously convert it to string so that it can be compared. And now in MATLAB, you can compare multiple case values using a cell array of strings like I have made here. So for the months January, March, May, July, August, October, and December, we'll have 31 days. Okay, so we'll just change the items in the start day drop down, all right, and make it 31. And again, for the remaining months, except for February, we'll have 30 days, all right. For February, the number of days will depend upon the value of the year as well, right? So we'll look if the year is divisible by 4 to see if it's a leap year or not. After that, we'll see if the year is divisible by 100 as well as divisible by 400, so that we can see that the year is a leap year or not. So if the year is leap year, we'll actually display the days starting from 1 to 29, okay? And if the year is not divisible by 4, it will not be a leap year, and we'll only have 28 days. for the month of February. So that's about checking whether or not the year is leap year and showing the days accordingly for the month of February. After that, we'll have to add the element day in front of the items that we have chosen for these drop-down menus. Okay, so we just don't want to display the numerical values from one to some value for the days, right? We want to display first a string called day so that the user knows that he needs to choose the day value from that particular drop-down menu. So we are just adding the string day in front of the start day drop-down menu items. And we are making the value equals to day so that the first option that is displayed will be day and not any numerical value from 1 to the last element or the last value day of that month. Okay, so that's something that we'll do for the end month drop down value changed callback as well. Okay, so we can add a callback for the end month drop down menu as well by going to callbacks and then the same thing. The method is just the same, except for the fact that the name of the drop-down menus will change. All right, so that's about how we can display the day depending upon the month and the year chosen by the user. So now let's just move on to the next callback function, which is the fetch data push button callback. So this is actually the callback for the button, and it will be executed when someone clicks on this button. So what we can do is we can just go into callbacks and add a button pushed callback. Okay, so I'll just show you how to do that in this new application. I'll just add a button over here. All right, I go to callbacks and I'll add a button pushed callback over here. Okay, so that's how we can create a callback for the button as well. In this callback, you will see that I have written some code. So let's just begin with the first line. So what I'm doing is I'm just saving the values that has been chosen by the user from the drop-down menu. So I'm saving the values of all the date values. So I'm saving the drop-down values from the start year, start month, start date. So start day, and then end year, end month, and end day. And I'm saving these values in appropriately named variables, like STY for start year, ENY for end year, and so on and so forth. And I'm saving these values because I need to make combined date using the month, day, and year values. After that, I'm saving the value for the frequency chosen from the frequency drop menu in the variable app, the frequency. And similarly, I'm saving the value for the stock symbol that the user can select from the ticker drop-down menu. And I'm saving it in the variable app.ticker. So as I told you that we were using this particular value in this function over here, right? App.ticker and sdate and edate, so at the frequency. So that's how we actually obtain the values of those variables over there in the function. Now, we don't need to pass any values in these functions, you will see, because these particular variables, app.ticker and the other app.variable names, are actually variables which were declared inside the section for properties. And any variable declared in this section can actually be accessed throughout the application, right? So that's why we don't need to pass any variables to any functions for this particular application. So once we have saved the values for frequency and ticker in appropriately named variables, what we'll do now is we'll just use these variables for day, year, and month and combine them to form some dates and save those dates in the variables app.sdate and app.edate. So we are saving them in this format, like we are first saving the day, and then the month, and then the year, all separated by dashes over here like this. Okay, so we can actually concatenate strings in MATLAB by simply using the square braces, and we have used that over here. Now we have only used the first two letters of the date because that's enough for the day value, and we have only used the first three values of the month because when converting these date values to Unix time values, which the Yahoo Finance can understand, we'll use some functions that only accept dates in this particular format. Okay, so that's why we are saving the dates in this particular format of day, then dash, month dash, and then year, with the month in the short format. Now, in these two lines, we are converting the dates from this format to a Unix time format. Now, first we'll convert the date to a date time value, and then use the function POSIX time to make it a Unix time date. Now, we have to convert this to date time first because POSIX time function only accepts date time values. Now, after this, what we'll do is we will change the value of frequency here. Now, as you have seen that in the frequency section, we have mentioned daily, weekly, and monthly. Now, these values are values that the Yahoo Finance can understand. The Yahoo Finance takes in D for daily, MO for monthly, and WK for weekly. So what we'll do is, we'll, depending upon what the value of app.frequency is or what the user has chosen, we'll change the value of app.frequency to D, MO, or weekly. Okay? And after we have done all that, we'll simply call the read data function and then display data function. So we are calling the functions now because now we have the values we need in the URL. We have the dates here, right? S date and E date. We have the frequency. We have the stock symbol value as well in app.ticker. So now we can call the function read data table, and then we can call the function display table so that we can display the data in the table. And finally, what we'll do is we will make the button for fetch data disabled. All right. So you must be wondering, like, the button was already disabled by like in the startup function callback, right? Over here. So we did not actually enable it. Actually, we have enabled it, and that was enabled when the user selects the company symbol from the ticker drop-down menu. Now, we have done that because this is the last thing that the user will choose, and after that, the button can be made enabled. So you will see that we have a value change callback for this drop-down menu as well. And if I go into that, you will see that the only command I have here is to make the button enabled. Okay, so when the person has selected something from this drop-down menu, we'll just enable the button. Okay, so that's how we enable the button, and once the button has been enabled and the user clicks on it, these lines of code which we have in the fetch data button pushed callback will run, and after it has run and the data has been displayed, we'll make the button again disabled so that the user cannot again click on the button to get data which is not unique. So we don't want recurring data, all right, for now. After that, what we'll do is we'll use a callback function. We'll define a callback function for the plot data button. And if I go into the callback, you will see that I only have two lines of code. One to call the function that plots the data, and the other one which actually makes this particular button disabled. All right, so this particular button was actually disabled, if you remember again, in the startup function. So initially it was disabled, right? And we are again trying to disable it after we have actually used the function. But don't you think that we need to first enable the button in order for it to be disabled? And we can do that by making a callback function for the plot type drop-down menu, and inside it we'll just make the plot data button enabled. So what we can see very clearly is what I have done is I have made these buttons disabled at the start of the application and made them again enable at the last step of the data retrieval procedure, right? So what I have done is I do not want the user to unintentionally click on the fetch data button and receive an error message stating that some value from these menus was not chosen. So what we'll do is we'll just use the last menu and we'll make a callback for that and enable that particular button in that particular callback function. Similarly, for the plot data button, unless the user chooses some plot type, this button will not be enabled, and once the plot has been displayed, this button will again become disabled. So this allows the user to understand which menus have to be chosen in which order for the buttons to be used. So that's a very good way of letting the user follow the UI flow. Now finally, what we'll do is we'll make a callback function for the exit menu over here. Okay, and if I go into that callback, you'll see that I only have one line saying delete app. So this function delete app actually deletes the application that we have made. And by removing the application, the application will close and the window for the application will close. All right, so we have discussed all the callbacks that we have used in this historical data application, okay? And all that remains to be done now is to run it and see how it works.